Hi everyone, I'm very happy to be speaking at this Pulsar Summit Europe. My name is Christophe Bonnet. I'm a software engineer at DataStax. I work in the Luna streaming team. So Luna is our professional service for enterprises at DataStax around Apache Pulsar. I'm also a committer of the open source Apache Pulsar. And today I want to talk to you about the Pulsar binary protocol. So the agenda is the following. First, I will talk about the networking stack from the IP layer to the binary protocol. Then we will see how the frames are organized inside the protocol, and then how messages are exchanged between a client and a broker. About the protocol stack, the networking stack. So Pulsar is based on, is meant to be transported on the internet. So obviously the first layer is the IP layer. On top of this, it uses TCP. TCP brings over IP brings reliability because IP packets that are will need to be acknowledged and resent if they are not acknowledged. It also provides ordering. So if packets arrive out of order, TCP will reorder them for the applications. And then very important feature is congestion control. So the frames that are sent for TCP will depend on how the receiving side can handle them. And if it cannot handle them, then the TCP flow will stop. And on top of this, there's an optional layer of security in the Pulsar protocols. So using TLS, which is the security layer built for TCP. It brings security features such as encryption, privacy, checking of the remote. And also you can use it in Pulsar to do authentication. If you put a principal inside your client certificate, then it can be used depending on your configuration of Pulsar to authenticate the application. On top of this stack is the application level protocol of Pulsar, and we will now see we will see later how it's done. Would there be some alternatives to these stacks? So at the moment the Pulsar protocol was designed, the TCP plus TLS was really the only choice. Nowadays, we have new protocols that have emerged. The most prevalent one is QUIC, which is the protocol which is used in HTTP3. So QUIC is built upon UDP. UDP is a small layer, a thin layer on top of IP. And QUIC brings all the features that were in TCP and TLS to the UDP protocol. But it does it in a way that there are interesting features such as a faster connection than TCP plus TLS, because it will do both the security connection and the transport connection at the same time. So you can connect with a zero round trip. And so it's a faster way to connect. Also, an interesting feature of QUIC is that it has built-in support for multiplexing streams, which is not the case of TCP. In TCP, if you miss some packets, then all the packets that are waiting will not be able to be processed. With QUIC, if the packets that are missed are in another stream than other packets, the other streams will continue to be processed by the protocol. So this can be very interesting in a protocol such as Pulsar, where you could have different streams for different kind of operation. For instance, so one stream per producer, one stream for a consumer. QUIC is experimental in NET, it's a very recent protocol. When it goes GA, it could be a good idea to check if it could replace and could have an interest for the Pulsar protocol. The other one we can talk about quickly is SCTP, which is mostly used in telecoms. It has a weak adoption in public IP networks because hardware, NAT routers, and firewalls have only support for TCP and UDP and would generally block SCTP. So maybe not a good addition for Pulsar at the moment. About the protocol frame, so we see that we get a byte stream from TCP and we need to segment them in frames. So this is done by having the first bytes of the frame will be the total size of the frame, so we can know when the frame will end and when the next one will start. And inside the frame, it's divided between a command and an optional message, the message being composed of the metadata of the message and the payload. The message is an optional part, so it will only be sent when you need it. In case it's a command, it's a send command, or it's a command to transmit a message from the broker to a consumer. The encoding which is used for the command and the metadata is protobuf. Protobuf is a very interesting format because it has the characteristics of being binary, so it's really compact and it's fast to serialize and deserialize. It's described by an IDL, so it has a strong typed interface, which means that the protocol can generate clients and SDK for a server. It's also very evolvable, despite the fact that it's strongly typed, because there are features inside the protocol to provide evolvability, like declaring the fields, or some fields can be optional, etc. And also, it's supported by a wide variety of languages, so it's nice for systems such as Pulsar, because it means that drivers will be able to use these language supports for a wide variety of drivers. At first, Pulsar was using a patch version of Protobuf to bring support to bring optimizations around native buffers, especially recycling objects to have less allocations of objects, and also to provide a zero copy deserialization. But it was hard to maintain this patch version. So instead, it's now used a library maintained by Splunk, which is called LightProto, which brings all these features even more to the deserialization and serialization of Protobuf. I talked quickly about zero copy. Zero copy. If we want to achieve best performance possible, we need to avoid copying memory from region to region. So to do that, the protocol, the message inside the protocol is an immutable part. So once it's constructed by the client, it will not be modified by the broker when it receives it, and it will be transmitted as is to the ledgers. So this means that internally, the broker will not get this buffer, will not copy this buffer to the user space. The buffer will stay in kernel and be passed directly from the TCP socket of the client to the TCP socket used for the ledger. So this is very efficient, since the memory stays in the kernel. And if the user space wants to read from this, Netty has support to read from this memory, from this direct memory inside the kernel. Another important point about zero copy is that it's not possible to have zero copy for serialization using Protobuf, because Protobuf has a distinct structure in memory than on the wire. There are new protocols that have emerged, such as Captain Proto, Flatbuffers, or SBE, which have a direct representation of the wire in memory, but it was not the case of Protobuf. So instead of using of including the payload inside Protobuf, which would mean to have a copy of the payload when serializing it. The protocol buffer sends the payload outside of the protobuf message, and it's encoded actually inside the global framing of the message. An important feature of the protocol and of the payload is that you can batch message inside a single message. So batching message will give a real boost in performance in terms of throughput, because as it's immutable, you will write a big batch of message to the ledgers without having overhead to analyze and transmit multiple headers, etc. So it's really an order of magnitude that we get with message batching, and it's done inside the payload. You will divide your payload into multiple small inner messages. Each messages will indicate its payload size inside its metadata, and so we can know where a new message starts. And so this part will be immutable, like we talked about, and will benefit of zero copy. Now let's talk about how messages are exchanged between a client and a broker. So the first step, when a client has connected to as a TCP connection with a broker, is that it will open a session by sending a connect message. So this session is important because inside the session, we will perform the authentication only once during the connect message. And then we will not do authentication for the other messages, because authentication can be costly. For instance, if it's a JWTE check of we could check the signature of a JWT, which can be costly operation. So we want to do it only once and then operate inside the session. We also can exchange some characteristics about the client and the broker, like their version and what feature they support or do not support. To be sure that the link is always on between a client and the broker, TCP is not enough, because TCP doesn't have any keep alive mechanism. So if a TCP connection is gone, the client or the broker wouldn't know, and would only know after a long time when it sends a message. So instead, the client and the broker will send ping messages and wait for a pong message from the remote, which must be timely, or else they will they will believe that the connection is lost and try to reconnect. An important feature of the protocol is that all messages can be sent and received asynchronously. Even for RPC messages, it's not blocking, where you send a message and wait for the response before being able to send a new message. You can interleave all your commands by putting a request ID inside the command, and when the broker answers to this command, it will put a request ID in the response, and the client can then do the match between the request and the response. And the same way we can interleave RPC messages, we can have multiple producers inside the same connection. So producers are created using providing a producer ID, and then all messages that will be transmitted between the client and the broker will contain this producer ID for a given producer. So when it creates a producer on the broker, there are some resources that will be created on the broker, and they can be released by closing the producer at the end of the session. Inside the producer, when you send a message, you will say for which producer you send this message, and you will also provide a sequence ID of the message you send. So the broker, when it acknowledges by sending a receipt or an error to the client, it will say for which sequence ID it has been this message is sent. So you can have multiple sends in parallel from a given client to the broker, and the receipt will be received asynchronously. It's a bit the same way for the consumer, except that you will use the consumer ID when creating a consumer. Then the client will need to send flow message to the broker to say how many messages it can receive. And the broker will, in return, will send the messages to the client. It will include a message ID inside the client, this inside the message that is transmitted. And this message ID will then be used by the client to acknowledge the message it has received. And then, like the producer, when you want to release the resources on the broker, you close the consumer. And also, an important point, closing the consumer can be done either by the client or the broker. Let's talk about flow control, which is a very important feature of a streaming protocol. I already talked a little about it for TCP, but we also need to have a flow control at a higher level, because otherwise you could have a producer which would overrun a consumer. In the case of the publisher, so when the client publishes messages to the broker, the flow control relies on the TCP congestion control. So when it gets messages, the broker will put them in a queue before forwarding them to the ledger. And if this queue fills up and becomes full, then it will the broker will stop reading from the TCP socket, which means that the congestion control will happen, and the client will not be able to transmit more bytes on the TCP link. And then it's up to the client to react to this. In the Java client driver, for instance, there is a bounded queue of pending sends. So if you cannot transmit it over TCP, then the bounded queue will fill. When it's full, the driver will refuse new writes to this queue. And depending on the mode you choose, it will either send an exception to the calling application, or it will block the application. So if your application accepts this, you can block. So there's also a very interesting project, which is done by a colleague, which is with Larry Otari, which is around providing a reactive driver for Apache Pulsar. The reactive driver will provide the same functionality, but reactively. So it's async, but non-blocking. On the consumer side, when a broker will get messages from the ledger and try to send them to the consumer to push them. But if the consumer is too slow to read them, then the congestion control will happen on the TCP link, and the network buffer of the broker will fill. When the network buffer is full, then the broker will stop reading new messages from the ledger and wait for this buffer to have more available space. There's also another flow control mechanism from the client. The client can signal to the broker how many messages it can accept. So to do that, it sends flow messages, and the broker will only send messages with the same amount that was given in these flow messages. So in the Java client driver, for instance, the consumer has an internal bounded queue, receive queue, and when it will only send flow messages that represent the available space in this queue. About proxy support, so there's built-in proxy support inside Pulsar, because the problem when you put a proxy between a client and Pulsar and the broker is that it's not always possible to proxy the client credentials, especially if you're using TLS. You cannot proxy the client certificate. So instead, a client will authenticate with a proxy, and the proxy will then add the authenticated principle to its connect message to the broker. So then the broker can authenticate both the proxy and the client, and also check the authorization for both the proxy and the client. Eventually, let's talk about topic lookup, which is not completely linked to the protocol, but more like to how Pulsar works. In Pulsar, there's only one broker which can write or read from a topic at a given time. And there's a lead layer election mechanism that will choose this broker dynamically. So to know to which broker it needs to communicate with for a given topic, the client needs to send a lookup topic message, so it can send it to any broker, and the broker will answer, will give the URL of the owning broker as a response, and then the client can perform its operation on the other broker. So some references about this talk. So here are my informations where you can reach me. I'm available on LinkedIn. You can reach me on Twitter. Also, I'm active in the Apache Pulsar community on Slack and on the mailing list. If you want more information about the binary protocols, please go to the Apache Pulsar documentation. And also, if you want information about protocol buffers, there is documentation on the Google website. A small word on what we do at DataStax. So we are working on an offer. I'm personally working on an offer which is called Luna Streaming, which is enterprise support for Apache Pulsar. We also have a streaming as a service offer. You can run it on any cloud, and you can have some free credits just by signing up. So don't hesitate to try it. We are recruiting because the team for both Luna and Astra are growing. And this is the end of my talk. And I thank you very much. If you have questions, don't hesitate.